It's really a truly great pleasure to be here. And like Michael said, I wasn't sure I was able to get here. And normally, I never complain about storm. You know, you might know that why superstitiously I don't want to say anything about bad storm, but we really had a bad storm in New York, and I flew from Boston to New York and got trapped there, and took some negotiation to be able to get here, and I was tremendously grateful to Michael because. You know, at about 2:30 in New York time, which is 3:30 a.m., I found out that my flight was canceled. And when I talked to the travel to the airline, they told me that it was a miracle. We might be able to get you there Friday night. Do you want me to book that? But I have to maybe go through Canada or Japan and whatever to get you there. And I said, no. Don't book it first because. I don't know whether anybody would want to listen to my talk on Saturday, and you know, that's a day off. And then what do? I said, maybe I call Michael. Maybe he would forgive me. Oh, seriously, at 3:30 a.m., I woke up Michael. And then I said, I'm in this situation, and I'm not sure I can get here, but if I do get here Friday night, is it okay? And then I don't know whether he's already fully awake, but it took him a microsecond to say that, oh yeah, of course, it's okay. So it's incredible and really heartwarming. And now today I came here to see all of you here on Saturday, and then I learned that this is a very impressive place with all dedicated people. So no wonder a lot of good signs come out of here. So it's really double pleasure for me to come here and share with you something what we do. And I'm also really happy that I'm sure everybody here must be so motivated so that you are giving up your Saturday afternoon to listen to me babbling. All right, so I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we do. And the topic is about a super resolution fluorescence microscopy method that we recently developed. And that method happened to have the name STORM. And so here's how I'm going to organize my talk. In the first half, I'm going to be more technical and then try to give you the concept of this imaging method and try to be relatively quickly bring you up to speed with what's our most recent imaging capability in terms of spatial resolution, temporal resolution, you know, things like that. And then I'm going to give you a couple of biological examples in the second half to demonstrate some of the new things that we can learn. So with that, let me start with this. Actually, if this whole thing is long enough. Right. And so that I can see the slide. Right. So basically, as we all know, we learned a lot about biology from imaging approaches. And we also know that, of course, the living world really encompasses over a huge range of land scales, almost 10 orders of magnitude, and that is if I don't include huge animals like whales and so on. So human size about a meter all the way down to a few nanometers of protein size. Of course, with such a large scale, a range of land scales, we couldn't hope for any imaging method to really allow us to see things at every the entire scale. So there are many different methods has been developed to allow us, help us visualize things. For example, in the macroscopic domain, we have these really powerful approaches like PET, MRI, and CT. And these are not only techniques that allow us to learn fundamental biology, and they are really important clinical diagnosis tools. And microscopically, you know, one of the imaging modality that has been used a lot is light microscopy, and I'll tell you why and what are the advantages of this approach. And typically when we're talking about nanoscopic information, we refer to methods, such as electron microscopy, and for the more physically oriented people, scanning probe microscopy like AFM and ENSOM and STM, even in some cases. And these are methods with really exquisite resolution. And then if we care about atomic arrangement inside the molecules, so then we use techniques such as X-ray crystallography and nowadays and NMR, and nowadays single particle EM reconstruction also allow you to get to atomic resolution. So as I said, one of the things that we use to investigate the microscopic world, especially cell biology a lot, is this light microscopy imaging modality, especially the fluorescence mode. And that is because really light microscopy has a number of advantages. And two of them are pretty well recapitulated by this movie that I just downloaded from Bruce Albert's book, Molecular Biology of the Cell. So what you see here are dividing embryonic cells. The green is staining for microtubule, and the blue for DNA. So immediately what you see is things are moving and changing all the time, and that is because light is pretty minimally invasive, so that really allow you to study living organisms without worrying too much about light damage. Although that sentence should be qualified, because you really want to be careful. In some cases, light could cause damages. And then the second is because light microscopy has reasonably high time resolution, so you can catch real-time dynamics. Now, the second advantage is also very clear here, and that's you see different colored objects. And that's because, for one, light has so many different colors. And also, there are so many different colored fluorescent probes, be it fluorescent protein, dyes, fluorescent dyes, quantum dots, and so on. Also, there are many different chemical approaches that has been developed that allow us, or biochemical approaches, that allow us to link these fluorescent probes to the target molecule of interest was extremely high specificity. So when you combine all these together, what you have in hand is a method that allow you to image different gene targets inside the cell in real time, so that you could look at their interaction network and study biological processes that way. So that's a very powerful aspect of light microscopy. However, light microscopy also has its downsides, and that is its resolution. So the resolution of light microscopy traditionally is only several hundred nanometers. While that might seem small, things inside the cell, they're much smaller. You know, proteins are often just several nanometers in size. And moreover, cellular environment, as we now know today, is a very crowded environment with proteins existing in high density. So if you really want to conclude whether molecules are interacting with each other, what you need ideally is a resolution that is on the order of molecular scale. And it is for that reason, really much of our knowledge today about the ultrastructure information inside the cell come from this other imaging modality, electron microscopy, which really, as I said, has exquisitely high resolution that is on the molecular scale. However, electron microscopy, at least until now, is not yet live cell compatible. We cannot get real-time dynamics from electron microscopy. Also, you know, if you want to do molecular specific, sort of multicolor electron microscopy approach is still difficult, although there are ways to do that. I know, you know, traditionally immunogold, which, you know, we know that there's a downside of labeling efficiency, but I think from the talk you heard yesterday, you probably heard some high efficiency EM labeling approaches and so on. But so was the advantage of light microscopy being able to do live cell, multicolor, high efficiency molecular specificity labeling. What we hope is we can extend the resolution of light microscopy sort of all the way down to the molecular scale, so that we could bridge the gap that was existing between light and EM, light microscopy and electron microscopy, and then using these approaches, combine these approaches, and then in the end also with other imaging modality, so we can get a more complete picture of the inner workings of the cell. So that's the goal. And I do want to tell you that even though our goal is perhaps a 1 nanometer resolution, we haven't really accomplished that yet. But I'm pretty excited to tell you that we're reasonably close now. So I'll try to tell you our recent advances that get us to several nanometer resolutions. So first, just a little bit of physics. And that is why the resolution is limited. And we know that it's often called the diffraction limit. And that is because light is a wave. As any wave, it's subject to diffraction. And what does that mean if you translate that into microscopy term? That means if we try to focus light, no matter how good a lens we have, the focal spot has a finite size. Even if you try to find the best objective in the world, you still have a dimension of the focal spot that is about a couple of hundred nanometers in this lateral dimension, almost a micron in this axial dimension along which light propagate. So imagine you use such a spot, which is also what we call a point spread function, and scan your sample just like you're doing a confocal imaging. Now, if you have sharp features that are widely separated, each one of these sharp features will be broadened by the spot size. Now, if they're far away from each other, the broadened image still are separated, resolvable. As these features get closer and closer together, eventually there's a point where these two images will overlap to a point that you just get a single peak without any dip in the middle. And that single blob is that point you stop resolving these two things. You know, when you see a single blob like that, you could say, maybe I have one molecule, maybe I have 200 molecules or a million molecules. That's all possible. So that limit means that the resolution limit is basically the size of this focal spot or the point spread function. And that was originally recognized by Ernst Abbe, and that's why, actually in the 1870s, so it's why it's also called Abbe resolution limit. Now, with that in mind, at least on the hindsight, one could come up with a couple of different type of philosophies to actually break the diffraction limit. And one is, okay, if this spot size is troublesome, and if we have some smart ways of shrinking it, and then I scan the sample with a smaller point spread function, I would be able to get higher resolution. And that is the principle behind these approaches called stimulated emission depletion microscopy, or its generalized form, resolve microscopy, which is pioneered by Stefan Hale at Max Planck Institute. And I guess due to time limit, I won't go into the detail of this. And then also there's another approach which works in the frequency domain to actually using structure illumination to beat with the sample information. So basically, if you have pattern illumination, beat with the sample information and bring the high frequency down to the low frequency, you can also actually improve your resolution. And that's called a structure illumination microscopy, especially the saturated form also breaks the diffraction limit. And that's developed by Mats Gustafsson, John Sadat, Dave Eggert in the US, and Rainer Heinzmann and co-workers in Europe. And here, you know, let me just say a couple of words. So, you know, you use a stimulated emission depletion beam that has a donut shape that sort of trim the fluorescent spot. And then you get a thin, smaller spot, and then you use that smaller spot to scan your sample. You get higher resolution. So these are approaches that you try to use pattern illumination to effectively shrink the point spread function of your microscope, and then with that to get higher resolution. Now there is a second philosophy of, or second type of approach of how to get super resolution, and that relies on single molecule imaging. So we know actually in the single molecule field for quite a long while now that even though the image of a single molecule is still diffraction limited, means that the width of the image is still a couple of hundred nanometer wide. Nonetheless, you can get the center position of this image with a much higher precision. And that localization precision is roughly equal to the width of the image divided by the square root of the number of photons you detect. Say if I detect 10,000 photons, square root of 10,000 is 100. And if this width is 200, then 200 divided by 100 is 2 nanometers. So I can actually localize the molecule with 2 nanometer precision. Now that is actually a very powerful approach that has already been used to study biological systems and resulted in beautiful results. But that alone doesn't really break the diffraction limit because it requires well-isolated images so that you can find the center position. So if you have two molecules and each one already give you these two well-isolated images, that actually means you already resolved them by your conventional microscopy. So the problem is as they get closer, as I mentioned earlier, and to a point that their image overlaps severely, how do you deal with that? How do you find the position of these molecules? Oh, you say, well, how do you do it here? I do it here by, say, fitting it with a Gaussian to find the peak position. You say, oh, well, there's nothing to it. I fit with two Gaussians, then I can find two. What if I tell you there are five molecules there? You say, oh, I fit it with five Gaussians. What if I tell you there are 5,000 molecules there? Maybe at that point you will pause and think a little bit and then, you know, not really saying that I fit it with 5,000 peaks and find out where the center position is, because the error propagation will actually really kill you. And in reality, biological specimen often has complex structures like this with images of individual molecules severely overlapping, and how are you going to find the positions of individual molecules? So here's where we came in. So several years ago, we and others had come up with this approach by taking advantage of photoswitchability of fluorophores and then physically return the situation back to single molecule imaging condition. So here's what we do. You know, we know that some fluorophores can be switched between fluorescent state and dark state. And often they can be switched by light going from a dark state to a fluorescent state. So if you use weak enough activation light, what you can accomplish is only a subset of the molecules in your field of view are turned on. Such a small subset that their images no longer overlap with each other. And then you can fit each one of these images with a Gaussian and find their centroid position. Now then what you do is you turn off the subset, and then you turn on another subset, and then you determine their positions, and then you iterate this process until you determined nearly all the molecular coordinates in your field of view, or at least a sufficient number of them that can give you the underlying structure with high definition. In other words, those overlapping images to start with, I stretch them out in the fourth dimension, in the time dimension, so that they're not overlapping anymore, allow me to find the position of individual molecules. Now, because here's what I want to emphasize. This method is intrinsically a wide field approach. You know, very often I felt like maybe I wasn't clear enough. I sometimes get these questions of, well, how do you turn on this molecule and not a molecule 20 nanometer away if you don't have the resolution? You know, I indeed don't have the resolution to tell me to exactly turn on this, but not the neighboring one. It's all stochastic. I know that I turn on only 0.1% of the molecule, but I don't know which 0.1%. So it is for that reason we term this method stochastic optical reconstruction microscopy, because if I do 0.1% at a time, I do 1,000 times, see, then I can get pretty much all the molecules. So that's where the name comes from, STORM. And I should say that as we publish our paper, there are a couple of other papers that are published almost simultaneously by the group of Betzig, Hess, and Jennifer Limpenkosch was, and they termed this a very similar approach, POM, or a different Hess, and called this approach FPOM. So here's how you apply STORM to a real situation like this. And you can see that we turn on a subset at a time, we determine their position, and we plot out the position on the right-hand side. And then if you do this for a sufficient amount of time, what you come up with images like this. And these are microtubules inside the cell. And this is in the same field of view what a conventional image would look like. So you can see immediately that you have a substantial resolution gain. And in my lab, we developed and we actually discovered many different colored fluorescent probes that are photo-switchable. And these are just some of them. And there are also other photo-switchable probes that has been discovered by other labs. So with that, we can now either use different colored photo-switchable probes that emit different color to do multicolor imaging, or we also invented this way that we use the same colored photo-switcher, but different colored light to activate them through the help of an activator, and then through that to do multicolor imaging. So we can actually get multiple color storm images. And here is one of our early two-color storm image of microtubules together with a clathrin-coated pit. And again, here is a superposition on top of it, the conventional image. So what I found most telling here is this structure called clathrin-coated pit. It's these these structures that are important for endocytosis, and they're really truly diffraction-limited object. What I meant is the diameter is about 100 nanometer, so it's below the diffraction limit. So if you try to image it with conventional microscopy, all you see is just a blob without any structural information. And in contrast, at the storm level, we can begin to see its spherical morphology as you would expect, because we are looking at the protein coat on the endocytic vesicle, or half of the vesicle that is about to bud. And also, since it's a protein coat, you would imagine it to be hollow. It's already showing some sign that it's hollow here, but it's not entirely hollow because this is a two-dimensional projection image. So if you have a cup-like structure, then the center would also project to the middle. So that actually means that we actually need to do super-resolution imaging or break the diffraction limit in all three dimensions. And so you actually, in principle or conceptually, it's not that hard because if we do that by determining the position of molecules for 2D in XY, all we have to do for 3D storm is to determine XY and Z position of all molecules. Then you would have a 3D storm image. So it's slightly easier said than done, because typically when you take your image with a camera, that's absolutely a two-dimensional image. So how do you determine the Z position of molecule? It's really not that hard. If you have played with microscopes, so you all have seen this phenomena. That is, things in focus, you try to adjust your focus knob, things in focus typically look nice and sharp. Things out of focus look blurry. And what does blurriness mean? It means your image tend to be broader and dimmer. Okay. In other words, if you get the shape of this image, it actually tells me the Z dimension information. Except in this case, above and below focus, they look blurry in a similar way. So you have a degeneracy. You can't tell minus Z from plus Z. So we actually came up with this approach that really is so simple, but then it easily dealt with this degeneracy problem and also is very sensitive. And that is, we insert a cylindrical lens in the detection pass. A cylindrical lens only bent in one direction but not the other. So as a result, you only bent light in one direction and not the other. And with that, what you get are these single molecule images that are elliptical rather than spherical. And their ellipticity depends very sensitively on the Z direction of the on the Z position of the molecule. Moreover, you can see that below focus and above focus, they're elongated in two perpendicular directions, naturally break this degeneracy. So with that, we can actually convert this 2D projection image into this kind of a three-dimensional image. So what you see here is the computer is actually scanning through localizations at different Z value. If I just cut across, take a cross-section near the plasma membrane, what you see is actually these hollow spherical ring-like structure, as you would expect for a protein coat on the endocytic vesicle. And this is a 3D image, so for I can show you all 3D perspectives. So here is, again, this filled up 2D projection image of a single clathrin-coated pit. And then here is a cross-section, XY cross-section near the plasma membrane, so you can see the ring-like structure. And then if I take a vertical cross-section of this structure, and then you can see the cup-like shape. So altogether, it really gives you this pit-like shape as you would expect. And this is actually often what you see in textbook. So what is the resolution? Even here, visually, you can already appreciate it because, as I said, this is about a 100 nanometer size structure, and this is a 100 nanometer scale bar, and we can clearly resolve this kind of a nanoscopic structure. Quantitatively, we can localize small molecule at that time was about 8 nanometer precision in XY and about 20 nanometer precision in Z, which converts to the resolution of the distance between the two molecules we can unambiguously resolve is about less than 20 nanometer in XY and less than 50 nanometer in Z. So to put that in perspective, it's about 10 times better than confocal microscopy. So if you have a 10 times better resolution, you could imagine that there are many subcellular structures that you can see with a much higher clarity, and then you can learn a lot more about cellular structures. But the truth is, although you can learn a lot of things already with this resolution, there's still a lot of structures that are too small to resolve even with this 20 to 50 nanometer resolution, because after all, molecules inside the cell are a lot smaller. So there's a need to continue to improve the resolution, and then I'll tell you a couple of recent work. The projector doesn't come out so well, but nonetheless, let me just tell you that one of the structures that is very difficult to resolve, even by super-resolution fluorescence microscopy, is actin. Actin inside the cell are packed in very high density, and they're very thin, so that it's a very difficult subject to resolve. And we recently improved the resolution by twofold by inserting the specimen between two objectives, so that we not only detect twice as many photons, but also this allow us to cancel out noise in many different ways. And with that, we improve. And then the 3D is still done by cylindrical lens and astigmatism imaging. And with that, we improve the resolution by twofold. Now we have a localization precision of about 4 nanometer in XY and 8 nanometer in Z, which corresponds to a resolution about 10 nanometer in XY and 20 nanometer in Z. And with that, indeed, you can now resolve individual actin filament very nicely inside the cell. And that's still not enough. And then, but with that, we already learned something interesting about actin. That is, we found that actin ultrastructure is drastically different. You know, actin actually has two different layers near the cell front, and a layer close to the bottom of the cell and a layer close to the top of the cell, and they have very distinct structure. And we also learned that one of the molecules primarily responsible or important for this distinction is myosin, because if we actually inhibit myosin II activity, the two structures now look almost identical. But that's still not enough to resolve some other structures. As I said, molecule size are so small. So recently, we come up with some other approaches. And here's something interesting. That is, one could imagine many different discipline of people to help with this approach, because you could imagine that if you're good at optics, you can come up with some smart optical schemes to improve resolution, that like I showed you in the previous slide. If you're a good chemist, maybe you can come up with extraordinarily bright photoactivatable probes to help you improve the resolution. And after all, the resolution depends on the number of photons that we detect from these molecules. So recently, we come up with a scheme to actually cage the molecule in a very simple way. Was a reducing reagent. We can actually reduce the dye by adding a single covalent bond with hydrogen and then get the dye into a non-fluorescent state. Here I'm only showing you for size 3, but this approach actually works for many different dyes. And then this become a dark state molecule that I can photoactivate with 400 nanometer light. So this type of photoactivatable probe, we found that, as I said, it works for many dyes across the visible spectrum with many different color, and we can actually get for some dyes up to millions of photons per photo switching event, give me a resolution down to 2 nanometer. And we don't really have a 2 nanometer resolution image, because in order to truly benefit from that, I also need the labeling density to be so high so that every 1 nanometer I have a dye. So that hasn't been accomplished yet. Well, this really doesn't come out. We can what? Okay. Okay, well, maybe. So let me see. So basically, the idea is it's easy to explain. We try to use that to look at microtubule structure, because the microtubule is a hollow structure that we would expect it to have a 25 nanometer outer diameter and 17 nanometer inner diameter, and it's the 17 nanometer inner diameter that we're trying to measure. And then indeed, if I zoom in this image, you can see that these thin microtubule structure actually is a hollow structure with two lines. And then if I show you the profile, you can see that the two lines are separated by 16 to 18 nanometer width. And then you can imagine that here, along the 17 nanometer inner diameter is where you have the thickest red region. Right here you would have the thinner region, here you would have thinner region. So with that, we can precisely measure this inner diameter of microtubule. So, so that may be too dark. And then another thing that is important for Michael, you turn on the light for me. So another thing that is important for light microscopy, as I said, is the ability to do live cell imaging so that you can get dynamics. We can also get live cell 3D storm, actually in different colors. Let me actually just show you one snapshot. This is a two-color image of clathrin-coated pit. Together it was its cargo molecule transferrin that is internalized into the cell through clathrin-mediated endocytosis. And then you can indeed see still the cup-like shape of clathrin, and then the cargo inside the cup, or in this particular case, the cargo moving towards the cup. And here is how we did it. We find these very fast photo-switchable dyes, Alexa647. We link it to the target molecule through the SNAP-tag approach, a genetically encodable tag. And then the spatial resolution we get for this image is about 20 nanometer, and then temporal resolution is about 1 second. And this is taken with about a 1 kilohertz camera, about 1,000 frames, which means that if we want to track how molecules move in the structure, we actually have 1 millisecond time resolution. But if we care about how the morphology of the structure changed, since it takes a second to get it, in that sense, we have about 1 second time resolution. And recently, we also found that some of the dyes that you often use for your imaging, like plasma membrane dye, like dye D, dye I, or ER tracker, or mito tracker, these are the dye molecules that are so easy to use. You just add to your live sample for a few minutes, and then you wash away the solution, and then you can just image live cells with that. And we found all these to be nice photo-switchable probes that can give me super-resolution images, for example, of neurons or a spine, ER structure, mitochondria image nicely showing the inner crystae. And then you can get, because these are all live images, you can get the live the dynamics, in particular, for example, what you see here is the movie of mitochondria showing fission and fusion. And then we can also begin to learn something from these live cell images. For example, in this snapshot, what you see is the fission and fusion has this tubular intermediate, and then these tubular intermediate has about 100 nanometer width, which is similar width to the dynamine-related protein when they get reconstituted in vitro with membrane. They give you that kind of a width, although the dynamine-related protein induced tubular structure is conjectured or hypothesized to be the fission-fusion intermediate. It has never actually been observed directly. Now we can actually see that. And so another interesting thing, just for those people who are interested in dynamine, we found this very interesting thing. Whether it's fission or fusion, they have the same intermediate structure, at least from the morphology level, which is quite surprising because people actually had thought that fission and fusion go through different intermediates, even though they are using similar proteins. And you might wonder, how easy it is or what type of fluorophores it takes to do this kind of imaging, because at least maybe these days people don't ask me anymore, but in the old days people always ask me, if you need these very special fluorophores, does it apply to my system? If I'm interested in using it, can I? Actually, even back in day one, we mentioned that pretty much any optically switchable fluorophore, so whether it's a fluorescent dyes or fluorescent proteins, can all be used for storm imaging. And over the years, I think not only my lab, but also other labs have demonstrated that indeed there is a large list of probes that actually can be used for this imaging approach that include both photo-switchable and photo-activatable fluorescent proteins and photo-switchable and photo-activatable dyes. And these things, they're just like ordinary fluorescent proteins and dyes. You label your sample just like how you label your typical sample for fluorescent imaging. And this list is actually, again, every time I go through this slides, I feel embarrassed because I never get time to update this. This is a two-year-old list, so it really a lot of the new things are not there, even including the two examples that I've shown you just a couple of slides ago. But I want to give you the, I want to tell you this, and that is really there are so many photo-switchable dyes and fluorescent proteins available that you can use it to label your sample of interest in a way that is almost easy as you do confocal imaging. I say almost easy because labeling procedure is exactly the same difficulty. Except for super resolution, you probably need to label to a higher density than you can do than you want to do with confocal, so you might need to improve your protocol a little bit. So in the remaining time, I want to use some of our own examples to show you that we can indeed learn something new about biology through these super resolution approaches. I'm going to give you two examples, one in microbiology about imaging bacteria and the other in neurobiology. And they're also chosen because they use different type of probes. And this is using fluorescent proteins. And in this case, it's using fluorescent dye. So actually, what I meant by microbiology in this particular example is limited to just imaging bacteria. And bacteria imaging is, bacteria, I think, is one of those ideal objects to study with super resolution. And the entire reason is very well, revealed just by this slide. And that is because compared to mammalian cell, bacterial cells are tiny. And how tiny? The width is just several hundred nanometers, say 500 or 600 nanometers, which is just twice the diffraction limited spot. So very often, if you try to look at protein distributions inside bacterial cells, it looks like a blurry image. And then it is, in a large part, because of this imaging limitation, we really know much less about the cell biology about bacterial cells than what we know about eukaryotic cells or mammalian cells, which is quite ironic because if you think about it, it's a simpler cell. So in other words, we really need some super lenses to actually zoom in and give you much more clear images that look like this. So what you see here is actually storm image of individual mitochondria to see how they are distributed inside the cell. So the story here is about bacterial chromosome organization. And inside the bacteria, DNA is also compact and packed in a structure called nucleoid. And then if you take E. coli as an example, it's about 2 millimeter long DNA that is packaged in some submicron size nucleoid. So that more than 1,000-fold packaging is accomplished by many proteins. And among those are these bacterial major nucleoid associate proteins, or NAPs in E. coli. And we studied five of them, HU, HNS, IHF, FIS, and STPA. So these are, what I'm showing you, these are live cell storm images, but they're all snapshots. So for HU, we didn't really learn anything surprising. Basically, we can see that they're spread out throughout the nucleoid to give you this largely scattered image. And we found the same to be true for these three proteins, IHF, FIS, and STPA. But what's surprising is HNS. And you can immediately tell that they form this very distinctive structure, like these tight clusters inside the nucleoid. And they look, by eye, very regular. And indeed, if you look at them, the reason they look regular is because of two things, the number and the position of the cluster. The number increased was the cell length, and the cell length is an indication of the replication stage of DNA inside the cell for those freshly divided cell under condition that we know there should be most likely one copy of chromosome. We mostly see two such clusters, and these two clusters preferentially distribute along the long axis of the cell at the quarter cell position. And for those of you who study bacteria, you know that at the quarter cell position has a lot of interesting molecular machineries there. And if we want to, I mean, we to drive the message home that we have a pretty regular distribution, we actually created this strain of bacteria that cannot divide, but can keep replicating its DNA. So then you get this long cell, and then you can see the HNS form this linear array type of clusters, almost equal distance from each other, telling you that there's something there really regulate its distribution. And functionally, HNS is a global transcriptional silencer, and it silences about 5%, some 250 E. coli genes. So we wondered whether these genes that are silenced by bacteria, are their location also related to these clusters? And by imaging, we looked at two of them. One is HDEA, and the other is HCHA. And use RT-PCR, we confirmed that they are indeed repressed by HNS. And you can see that even by eye, there's a substantial colocalization that is backed up by quantitative analysis that I don't have time to show here. And also here, as a control, LAC-Z is not controlled by HNS, and then you don't see much colocalization. And indeed, the sequestering effect of this sequestering the gene loci into this cluster actually moved the gene locus by a long distance, because in wild-type cells, you can see that they're more or less at this quarter cell position. This thing also happened to be at the quarter cell position. But if I delete HNS, HDEA actually moved towards the cell peripheral, and HCHA moved towards the cell center, really by almost microscopic distance compared to the bacterial diameter. Of course, the whole bacteria don't have a microscopic size. And for a control one, like Z, you see that there's not much of a distance change. So that means if we have two such clusters per chromosome copy, and if they do sequester hundreds of genes into them, then we have a major organization force in the bacteria to organize and compact a bacterial chromosome. To test whether that's true, actually we wanted to both test whether that's true and see whether it has any functional consequence. So I'll describe both of these. Give you answer to both of these questions. So the first is whether they do bring many, many gene loci into close proximity. And you could do that by imaging all of this together with HNS. We do plan to do that. But also you can do some high throughput biochemical approach to see whether many different gene loci are brought into proximity. And that is through this a powerful approach developed by Joop Dekker and Nancy Kleckner called chromosome conformation capture assay, which is basically you use cross-linking to actually cross-linking two DNA segments that are brought closer together by protein. And then you digest to get this kind of product, and then you ligate, and you use PCR to probe the ligation product to see whether the loci are close. And then here is the result. It might look very complicated, but it's actually really very simple to explain. I'll start from the right-hand side. And these are what we call control experiment. And they tell you what the cross-linking frequency is between a pair of loci that at least one of them is not regulated by HNS. So a priori, we would not expect them to come close. And indeed, they have relatively low cross-linking frequency. On the left-hand side are the pair of loci that both partners of the pair are controlled by HNS. So they have a chance of being brought into the same cluster and get close together and get cross-linked. And indeed, across the board, you see, even though varying, but all much higher cross-linking frequency than the right-hand side. And moreover, if we delete HNS from the cell, you can see that the cross-linking frequency all dropped to almost background level, except for one. So it tells you that indeed many different gene loci that are regulated by HNS are brought into proximity to give you this effect. Now, the last question that I want to address about this example is, okay, so they bring many things together. They clearly can organize, you know, this force. You cannot deny that they do organize a chromosome. But are there any functional consequences of that? In other words, if I break up this cluster, do I see any gene expression level difference? So with that, we also have this approach that we know that HNS has these two major domains, a C-terminal domain that bind to DNA and an N-terminal domain that tend to dimerize. And then first we hypothesized that maybe the dimerization is what's responsible for cluster clustering. So we introduced a single point mutant into the endogenous copy of HNS to disrupt this effect. And indeed, after disruption, now you can see HNS do not form clusters anymore. They all spread out. But their DNA binding domain didn't change at all, and their binding affinity to DNA also didn't change at all. Now the question is, now they're not clustered anymore, did they still repress the genes as they did before? So when we looked at HDEA and HCHA, so let me walk you through, for example, HDEA here. This is the gene expression level measured by RT-PCR for wild type. And if we normalize that to 1, if we look at an HNS deleting cell, it's this white bar. So it's about 20 to 30 fold higher, telling you that HNS indeed repressed the gene expression. And here's the remarkable thing. If we take this single point mutant that merely just disrupt the cluster, you can see that they pretty much bring the gene expression level to a deletion mutant, telling you that indeed clustering is very important to keep this gene expression repression effect. So in other words, so what we have here is HNS form these tight clusters, about 2 per chromosome, and through that can globally organize the chromosome, serving, for example, as anchor point or organization centers, bringing numerous distantly located gene loci into close proximity. And this organization effect, or this HNS cluster formation, is actually important for its gene silencing function. And more recently, I don't have results to show here, we also found that there are physiologically relevant conditions to actually allow HNS to break apart or form the cluster. Just depends on whether it sees a, you know, rich sugar source or poor sugar source and so on. So this kind of chromosome organization effect is actually a physiologically relevant regulation factor, which is perhaps the first time that people actually see this global chromosome organization effect to be important for gene expression regulation under physiologically different conditions. So I can see that I went through this part maybe a little too slowly. I was going to show you another bacterial story about bacterial cytoskeleton. If you're interested, I can go back to this later, but maybe not all of you want to keep hearing all these bacterial stories. So let me actually, you look surprised. I think I'll just skip and then go to the next one. So let me actually just end up with a neurobiology story. And then in this particular case, we're looking at synapse structure. And synapse is what I call another really ideal subject to do super resolution study, because we know that they're very small. And these are the special cell-cell junctions that are responsible for signal communication between neurons and their target cells. And the typical central nervous system synapse size is just several hundred nanometers, in width, even though there are some bigger giant synapses. And within these several hundred nanometer synapse structures reside actually several hundred different types of proteins, different protein species. And some of them exist in high copy number. So that means it's a very crowded structure that has many, many molecules working in a concerted way to actually enable neurotransmitter-mediated signal transmission between across the synaptic cleft. So it goes without saying that if we do know how molecules are organized in the structure, that will give us some basis to understand the functional mechanism better. But it's a very difficult structure to image by conventional fluorescence. And I demonstrate it here by actually just a conventional fluorescence image of a slice of brain tissue. So basically, we labeled presynaptic scaffolding protein Bosun and postsynaptic scaffolding protein Homer 1. And then you can see that things are largely overlapping, even though you can see the red and green are not entirely overlapping, but we don't really resolve them very well. In contrast, for the same piece of brain tissue slice, if we do the storm imaging, and this is what you see. So you can actually see a much better resolution between these two protein structures. And here's a zoom in to show that this structure here, that we didn't even know from the conventional image how many synapses are there. But here we can see there are two. And then we also resolve the pre- and postsynaptic structures much better. This actually understates the resolution because, again, it's a two-dimensional projection. So if I actually show you the whole 3D view, this is what you see. So you can see the pancake-like structure for the presynaptic active zone and postsynaptic density. And then if we freeze at this transsynaptic view, then you can see the clear separation between the postsynaptic density and presynaptic active zone by the synaptic cleft. And another thing I want to emphasize, that this is not even culture cell anymore. This is actually brain tissue. So it means that this method also applies to tissue imaging. And we, since we can do multicolor imaging here in this case, even adding a third color already gives us a lot of additional power, because now we can systematically map out the position of molecules in the synapse. Because we could use two as references and then study the third one in reference to this frame that is set up by Bosun and Homer. And one could imagine that if you use two, and then one of them as reference, the other as the molecule of interest, and you can't place it left and right. You can't really build a structure. And with that, you know, for those of you who are familiar with synapse, GluR1 is an AMPA receptor subunit. So if you've had trained eye, you can see that indeed GluR1 drops in the synaptic cleft. And then if you have very observant eye, you can even see that it's a little closer to Homer than Bosun, because it's a receptor that should be on the postsynaptic terminal. And indeed, if you analyze its position, it's indeed closer to the postsynaptic density. So with this, as I said, we can systematically determine the position of many molecules. And then in this early work, that we actually determined 10 such molecules, and then we placed them, you know, in different positions along the synaptic axis. And then I will tell you a couple of things. First is, of course, there are prior knowledge about, you know, synaptic molecules, some of them where they are and so on. So we first want to use that to confirm whether we got things right. For example, the GluR1 position, its relative position to the synaptic cleft is exactly the same as what people has determined using EM. And we also see that PSD95, Schenck, and Homer form this laminar distribution progressively further away from the synaptic cleft, which is also confirming a previous knowledge from Weinberg lab using immuno-EM. But as I said, immuno-EM is having relatively low efficiency of labeling and so on. And then it took people many, many different work to get some knowledge. And here, you know, without too much difficulty, we get easily 10 proteins and where they are. And then we also learned something new. And I won't go through all of those new things, but I mentioned one of them, which I also found to be technically interesting. And that is, we can not only determine where the molecules are, we can even determine whether they are oriented by actually localizing or determining the position of different parts of the same molecule. We can determine the position of the N-terminal domain and C-terminal domain of this large scaffolding protein, presynaptic scaffolding protein, Piccolo and Bosun. And we found that indeed they're oriented with their N-terminal domain further away from the synaptic cleft than the C-terminal domain. And we can not only determine the position of molecules, we can also semi-quantitatively determine the composition of molecules. As people who study neuroscience knows, that the receptor composition is especially important for determining the transmission property of synapses. So we, in the same brain region here, we looked at the composition of GluR1, which is a subunit of AMPA, receptor and NR2B, which is a subunit of NMDA receptor. And indeed, we found the composition can be dramatically different even for synapses within the same brain region. And they almost look like two color images to you, even though these are all three color images taken in the same sample. And here you predominantly see only GluR1, no NR2B. And here you predominantly see NMDA receptor and no AMPA receptor. So if we actually quantify the ratio between these two receptors, we actually saw something really surprising. And that is, in this brain, we did that for a couple of brain regions that are nearby each other, main olfactory bulb and accessory olfactory bulb. And we found a large population of synapses in the accessory olfactory bulb that has very low AMPA receptor composition. They're predominantly NMDA receptors. And that's why this ratio is close to one, because this number is almost zero. And then they also, I don't have time to show here, but they also have very low Homer 1. So they have very immature postsynaptic density. So this is actually a type of synapses people already know. You know, silent synapses are like that. They pretty much have no AMPA receptor. They are NMDA receptor rich. And why do I say it's surprising? Because silent synapses is known to be sort of a developmental phenomena. So a newborn mice has lots of them. And a couple of weeks, they're pretty all matured. And here, what we see is, indeed, for adult mice in MOB, you have very few of these silent synapses. But in AOB, about 50% of these synapses that has this nature of being silent synapses. Not nature, I'm sorry, the receptor composition that look like a silent synapses, although I do have to be careful that one can only conclude that if you also do electrophysiology to actually measure it. So you wonder, you know, silent synapses, as I said, is a developmental phenomenon. It's also known to be important for long-term potentiation, you know, experience-dependent learning. So does that actually mean that, you know, half of the synapses in AOB is like this for some learning capability? We don't know the answer yet, but certainly it's a very intriguing hypothesis. But we did test whether they're plastic, meaning that we can stimulate them towards maturation. And we use this now well-known approach, optogenetics. And then here, the channel rhodopsin is actually expressed in vermonasal organ sensory neurons that actually synapse in the AOB region. And then we can use light to stimulate them. And then, indeed, upon stimulation, we can see a major shift of these synapses towards maturation by actually gaining AMPA receptor content. So with that, you know, I hope I have convinced you that you know, we can also have quantitative characterization about submolecular, subcellular structures like synapses, and then make new discoveries there. And then not only, I also want to tell you that this kind of imaging approach is not only very useful to look at tiny structures. Sometimes things very big that we don't consider that need super resolution actually also need high resolution imaging. One of this thing is, for example, how neurons are connected to each other. And what is the circuitry inside the brain? You might ask, you know, such a big thing, why do we need super resolution? But in the neuropil, you have axons that are so thin and so densely packed. And then if you want to actually resolve which neuron connects to which, you also need super resolution. So we also begin to actually work towards that direction by actually looking at large neuronal structures to look at synapse distributions on the neuron. You know, here we don't have multiple neurons connecting to each other. What I try to show you here is a field of synapses on the entire neuron, which it tells you that I should shut up because my power is almost. So, but we know that the distribution of synapses on the neuron actually tells us something about how single neuron actually compute. And here is a dendritic branch and showing you the synapses distribution and so on. So hopefully with this, I have convinced you that with super resolution approaches, so we really begin to approach molecular scale resolution. And dynamic, you know, we can do dynamic imaging with that. And then, so with that, and then of course many other imaging approaches, nanoscopic imaging approaches that I didn't have time to talk about, like some of those in the introduction part, the STATSIM and other approaches, and also non-fluorescence approaches. And I keep hearing people telling me that people are trying to do live cell EM imaging and so on. So hopefully when we combine all these molecular scale imaging approaches, we can really someday look inside the cell and then just see molecular events unraveling right in front of our eye. Or in the other way to say is we can perhaps do biochemistry in living cell with our eyes. So with that, let me actually just conclude by thanking people who has done the work. And the early STORM development is largely due to three very talented individuals, Dr. Bo Huang, which I think even spoke here once, didn't he? Or at some other Hong Kong universities. And Dr. He's a professor now at UCSF. Dr. Mike Rust is now an assistant professor at University of Chicago. And Mark Bates is now a postdoc with Stephen Hill. And some of the recent development, high resolution due to Ke Xu and Hazen Babcock for the dual objective imaging, Josh Wang for the very, very bright photo-switchable probes and live cell imaging due to Sun Hee Shim and Sarah Jones. Our bacterial chromosome work is a very nice collaboration with my longtime friend Sunny Shi, and person in my lab who did that is Wen Qing Wang, who went into finance. I don't know what I did to her so that she has to leave science. And the bacterial cell wall synthesis and bacterial cytoskeleton actually is due to Ethan Garner, a joint postdoc with Tim Mitchison's lab, and he's now a professor at assistant professor at Harvard. And the synapse work is another collaboration with Harvard professor Catherine Duluc and the person in my lab responsible is Bo Huang. And I would like to thank Hughes and NIH for support, and thank you very much for coming here on Saturday.
I'm sure you have a lot of questions that, there are people with microphones on the side, so just raise your hand, and okay.
So you just comment that to resolve smaller scale, the nanoscale things, you need a high density of labeling. I just wonder whether that such high density labeling will affect the actual dynamics and the function of biology. That because you introduce extra all kind of fluorophore to label it.
Right. So you know whether labeling affect the biological perturb the biological system significantly is always something that one really need to test. So I cannot say that higher density would necessarily lead to that, but that's a possibility. And one always have to test about labeling. Even low density, one have to test whether labeling affect. But you're right, you know, if you label very, very high density, you have a higher chance of perturbing the system. So I don't have really an answer to that. But one thing is dye is relatively small. And if you do have per protein molecule a single dye, there are many, many cases that lead us to believe that maybe perturbation wouldn't be so bad. Another area of our research, which I didn't have time to talk about at all, is we do single molecule FRET studies of enzymes in solution and so on. There, every enzyme we study has at least a pair of donor and an acceptor labeled on that. And for every single new biological system we study with that, we always test whether the functional output we measure is consistent with the previous biochemistry measurement without the dye. And the majority of cases, we don't find perturbation. So that gives us some confidence that it might become, it might be okay. But it's a perfectly good concern that for each individual system, one has to test.
Okay.
Thank you, Professor Zhang. First, thank you for your lecture. And my question is, since you do some statistical methods, you need time to sample, isn't it? So you have a relative low time resolution. It's about 1 second. And so does it mean that if something is very small, and it will undergo some Brownian motion, it will be blurred in your storm research? And if there is something happen to cause the time to quench suddenly for some reasons and periodically, can you distinguish this quench or increase or decrease in intensity? Thank you.
Right, so the first question, indeed, one always have to worry about motion blur effect. And that applies to no matter which imaging method you use. And there is always a rule of thumb, and that is if during the time that you image, your structure has moved by an amount that is larger than your resolution, then your effective resolution is lower. So in other words, in the storm case, if it takes me a second to image, and if I say I have 20 nanometer resolution or so, I have to make sure that the structure didn't move by more than 20 nanometer. So that's absolutely true. And then that said, there are two things I want to say, maybe three things. One is that there are structures that move that slowly, and there is freely moving molecules inside the cell that would be moving too fast for a storm to resolve at the moment. I also like to joke that if you already know that it's a freely diffusing molecule inside the cell, you already know its distribution. There's no reason for you to actually measure that with a super resolution approach. But that said, there are some freely moving multimers that you want to determine their structure. It's true, there are cases like that, but there are plenty of cases that move relatively slowly that you can distinguish. The second thing I want to mention is 1 second time resolution is what I showed you here for a specific system that I image. And for different systems, it's very special for this type of method, unlike confocal. For different systems, the time resolution can be entirely different because all it depends is how many localizations it takes me to determine a structure. For a large structure, it would take me more dots to give you the shape. If it's a pentamer freely moving in the cell, all I need is 5 dots to determine what the pentameric structure is. And with that, I can have actually much faster time resolution than 1 second, because after all, I don't need hundreds to thousands of dots to determine its structure. So keep in mind that there's not a fixed time resolution of storm. It all depends on which system you measure. And that said, there are also systems that would require me minutes rather than a second to actually determine the structure sufficiently. So both sides are true. Now, the other thing to keep in mind is it is a method that also allow you to see how molecules inside the structure move with a much faster time resolution than the overall time it takes to image. And that time resolution is basically my camera ray frame rate, 1 millisecond. So if you have some rapid movement inside a structure, you can also resolve that. So there are creative ways to actually get things done with high time resolution. But in general, your question is a correct one, which, as I said, applies to any imaging method, that motion blurring artifact is always one has to be concerned about. Now, your other question about quenching. That, I think, does relate to this question of very high density labeling. When you have very, very high density labeling, when the molecules get pretty close to each other, indeed, one could actually begin to observe a quenching effect. That said, for most of our images, we haven't observed that yet. So we have to see in a real application how close things have to be for me to be actually seeing that type of effect.
So if this thing happens, will it be a detriment
Right. See, I'm an experimentalist, so I always try by experiments. So I will have to do that to know. And then, as I said, with our experiment currently, we haven't seen that effect yet. It requires a very high density, very close distance between fluorophores to see this quenching effect. And how close they have to be, and at that distance, can I still switch molecules? Can I still switch one on, keep the rest off without quenching? All these are things we need to test, so we don't know that yet. You need different kind of labeling approach. So one possibility is there are tags that allow you to link dye to the protein of interest. For example, there are two ones that we are using right now. One is developed by Alice Ting at MIT. So these are about like on the order of 10 amino acid kind of tags. And they are linked to the protein target of interest, again, by genetic means. And then there's some enzyme like ligases, lipoic acid ligase, can ligate a dye to a specific lysine on that tag. And with that, this tag size is just about a nanometer in size. Another similar type of, not mechanistically the same, but SORTAG, which is also just a small number of peptide amino acid tag that actually you tag to the sample, and then sortase is the enzyme that actually link the dye to this tag. So there are ways to actually generate these kind of small tags. And even SnapTag is what we have used for the classrin image. SNAP protein is a smaller protein than fluorescent protein, GFP. So if GFP is 4 nanometer in size, one could imagine maybe a SnapTag is 3 nanometer in size. So there are tags that are relatively small that would allow you to do that. The question is really two things, so whether you can get sufficiently high efficiency in labeling so that each one of these tags are labeled. And also because even though the tag is genetically fused to the target of interest, linking the dye to the tag is a enzyme-assisted chemical reaction step. So there is not always 100% specific. So you could also be in that process linked some link dyes to some other off-target proteins. So size is not my biggest concern, but efficiency and specificity is something that one has to work on, I think, to bring it to the optimal level so that you can actually get this kind of very high resolution image.
My question is also about the resolution of the store. I wonder about the object resolution, because usually the manufacturing precision of ordinary object will not go to that higher accuracy, such as maybe 10 to maybe 10th of nanometer. So I wonder whether the malfunction of the object will distort the final image you got by this method, or did you use any very special object in your storm method?
So that is not much of a concern. There are good enough objectives that it really gives you point spread function that's pretty ideal, so that typically, all the resolution I reported here are experimentally measured resolution. It's true that if I calculate the theoretical resolution based on the photon number I get, the theoretical resolution would be even higher. But typically, I don't think it's because of lower quality objectives. it has other effects, like cameras maybe not ideal because the pixel response from one pixel to the other might change a little bit. And you know, if your dye is not freely rotating, the dye dipole effect, it could have some effect. And there are some aberrations because your system is always not 100% index matched, and then you go from oil objective to water samples and so on. All these could contribute, or some drift correction that's not fully corrected. But defective objective is not something that is high on the list. That said, it exists, so you do want to test. It's not that hard to see whether your objective will give you diffraction-limited point spread function. You just measure it yourself and see.
Okay. So I have another question. Whether you used a standard sample, such as we know the space of different point, for example, in 10 tens of nanosecond, and use that as a standard to calibrate your method.
Yes, so that's a very good point. You know, pretty much our first STORM paper is entirely about that, and we learned that image cell is much easier than doing that, because I first have to come up with a standard. So we actually put, I didn't show that, we put dyes on the DNA, and then DNA, you know, space between different, you know, distance between bases is a pretty well-defined number, and with that we can measure very accurately, if we put them, you know, this number of base apart, what the distance should be, and then we confirm that to be the case.
Thank you.
Okay, any other question? Okay, I think, okay, this last two.
Okay.
Hello, I'm an undergraduate exchange student from Korea, and I really appreciate for your amazing talk. And I remember that there is some photo-switchable dyes, which is not only by certain wavelengths, but also by certain chemical. So I'm just curious that have you ever tried both ways simultaneously?
Right, so first of all, this new approach that I showed you is a combination of these two, right? We use a chemical reagent to turn it off, the sodium boron hydride, without light. You just add sodium boron hydride to your sample, all the dyes are dark, and we turn it on by light. And you're right, there are also ways to actually purely with reagent to switch molecules on and off. And these could be either by reducing an oxidation reagent or by some reversibly binding chemical quenchers. And then these two ways are the things that you don't have to use light to actually create a sort of switching effect. And we haven't tried either one of them. And so I cannot really speak for exactly how well they work. But they do exist.
OK, thank you.
And my question is that I find that you mentioned the dyes, the ultra-bright photoactive dyes. And also, you're using some chemical method to modify these dyes, right, in your slide. And my question is that, is it necessary for that using more ultra-bright dyes to achieve higher resolutions STORM images?
Well, how do I answer that? Since I obtained higher resolution, so
yeah,
I think it's helpful.
I think that my question is focused that for the future, is it necessary for the dye will be the key or will be some effect factor to a higher resolution image, like to several nanometers?
So to me, probe itself, dye or fluorescent protein or so, is one of the major things that can be improved to improve the resolution. And imagine any optical schemes you know, to improve the resolution, we're pretty happy if you get a factor of two or so. And in principle, if a die is 100 times better, in principle, I can get 10 times higher resolution. So you can make a bigger difference with die. Now that said, the higher resolution you get, the more deviation you have from a theoretically calculated resolution using photon number. A lot of things that didn't kick in at lower resolution start to kick in at a higher resolution, such as aberration and dye orientation and things like that. So improved optics to allow you to get the full potential of the bright dye is also needed when the dye gets brighter. So you could say that, oh, since you already have a dye that gives you a million photons, is there any need to further develop better dyes? Well, nothing is really ideal. I can tell you that this this approach we get, you know, if we use the 1 million photon dye, only 20% of them can be reactivated. And then some of the other dyes that we did, which is only, say, 100,000 photons, then I get 40% of them reactivated. And then if I had 10,000 photons, I get 70% of them reactivated. So they're not perfect. So there's still room for improvement for making an extremely efficient photo-switchable dye that's bright. And second, the way that we use to generate it is by sodium bromohydride. And then I don't want to put a sodium bromohydride to a live cell. You know, this is a pretty problematic reagent for a living system. So you could say that, what if I could synthesize this dye that already has the hydrogen attached to it so that you don't actually need to reduce it on your sample. You synthesize it, you purify it, and then you label your dye, your molecule with it, and then you activate it. Then you can use it for live cell imaging. A lot of these bright dyes are not cell permeable. You can engineer dyes so that they're cell permeable so they can label your target much more easily. So in other words, if you're a chemist, I'm trying to convince you that there are a lot to do in the probe front that you can still do to help the super resolution to reach higher resolution.
Any last questions? Okay, last.
My question is a physics question. Actually, in the two-dimensional imaging, the resolution is in principle limited by the statistical properties of the photon number.
Mm-hmm.
And so what's limited the resolution in the z direction? So I cannot get a straightforward answer here, I think. Because
it's also the same statistical thing about photon, right? You just imagine, you know, there are different 3D localization methods. So for each one, it might be slightly different. But in this case, just imagine, I have a point spread function that has a three-dimensional shape. So actually, what I get in the z dimension is about always twice longer than the xy dimension. And the point spread function to start with is twice bigger than the xy dimension. So in principle, you know, the number of photons limit the amount of information. And then if you use information theory to calculate, there is a bound that you can get. And that really is determined by statistical theory and the shape of the point spread function. That said, one could engineer different shape of point spread function. We now even have a shape of point spread function that is isotropic so that we don't have to have twice worse resolution in Z. And there are other approaches like interference to get the Z information. That's a much more sophisticated setup, but it does give you higher localization precision. The problem is it always requires a two objective with interference alignment, which both make live cell imaging difficult and make alignment very difficult. So,
but still, now the resolution in the z direction is not as good as in the xy direction yet.
Only in some cases. As I said, in the isotropic point spread function case we have, it's identical. So.
Okay, I know. Thank you.
I think we should stop here and thank Professor Zhang for an exciting talk, and particularly, she has been working very, very hard since 8:30 this morning. nonstop. So let's give a good hand.
Thank you.